Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art.
Hi, I'm P. Scott Cunningham, and from the studios at South Florida PBS, this is Art Loft. Hi, I'm Miami-based poet P. Scott Cunningham, and I'm thrilled to join the creative team presenting this season of Art Loft. In this episode, art projects rooted in multiculturalism and social activism. We begin with Reading Queer as the group brings together four remarkable poets for an unforgettable night of words and performance at Miami's historic Olympia Theater. Inspired by the cult classic film Paris is Burning, Reading Queer's event affirms Miami's diversity.
We're a 1926 historic film and vaudeville venue. We've been serving the community for, starting in February, 90 years. Tonight you're here for the test launch of In the Lobby Lounge, etc., which is our sort of hat tip to our traditional vaudeville roots. It'll wind up being a variety format of entertainment featuring everybody from comedians to maybe even burlesque.
My name is Neil De La Flor. I'm the executive director of Reading Queer. Reading Queer promotes queer literary culture in South Florida. Our partnership with Miami Book Fair came about by me asking Lizette Mendez from the Book Fair to partner with us. She said yes, and we ran with it. The title of the event is Paris is Still Burning. The event features contemporary queer poets of color. It was originally produced by acclaimed poet Patricia Smith.
Yeah, tonight I'm going to be performing a lot of newer work from my upcoming collection, but all of it's going to be work that centers around black queer bodies, black trans bodies, the violence that is executed on us, and also the celebration of ourselves as well.
Sad so many of his sons would shame his sons for walking a daughter's stride, for the way his children would learn to hate the kids, and on the 13th day, God barely moved. He laid around heaven dreaming of glitter, pleased with the shine of it. Sad so many of his children would come home covered in it, the parades canceled due to a rain of fists and insults and bullets and rope, and on the 14th day, God just didn't know what to do with himself.
One of the pieces that I'm going to do is related to an artwork by the African-American artist Carrie Mae Weems. And it just seems relevant for this time. It's really about being a black female artist, or the subject of art as a black woman.
You wail, a mimic mouth, into beaded rhythms of usness, fragrance of a cosmos where roads are not partitioned, no roads, no marks to mark up the whole big wide world.
Avoid his boots from under the mercury marquee, except your aunt, the invisible lady, naked in the yard, mustached and fat, fixing her car's transmission by sanding moons on the body at night.
I was already reading at the Miami Book Fair, and some of the organizers asked if I'd like to be involved in this event, and I jumped at the chance. I was like, are you kidding me? It's that, and there's a ball afterwards. Why would you not?
My name is Jameer Baptiste, and I am the organizer for the mini ball. Well, a mini ball is not really an official term for a ball. It's something that Reading Queer and associates have come up with to give the audience a glimpse of what a ball is. A ball is actually an affair that people go to actually dance, express their talents in many different forms and categories. One prevalent and actually important aspect of a ball would be considered voguing, which is common to people, but it's an element in the LGBT community that is cherished and worked on and really, really, really important to a lot of people in the ball scene.
I would like the audience to take away hopefully just some fun and some joy for those queer people of color that are in the audience tonight, to have give us a place to like celebrate and just be ourselves. But also just these narratives that are often hushed by the media that we've been trained to become apathetic towards. I hope that we can carry those stories outside of here with us as we, you know, the world's terrible all around us. And so hopefully we can do some work to be a little bit better to each other tonight.
Kanupa Hanska-Luger, a sculptor from Santa Fe, believes that great art comes from a desire to communicate complex ideas. Hanska-Luger teaches us about ourselves by using animal figurines in his work. New Mexico PBS brings us an exclusive interview with the artist.
So much of this clay building is by feel and less by what I'm actually seeing. So I used to zone out, and I'd be working on a piece using my hands, but staring off into the studio, the other students working, and not really paying attention to what my eyes were falling on. And many a time got the, what are you looking at? What are you looking at?
What inspires you to work as an artist?
Communication. Desire to talk, and that the ideas are open-ended, which is what's important to me. That the communication that I desire isn't textbook truths; it's honesty and it's sincerity. I find truth to be really rigid and fragile, whereas honesty and sincerity has a level of pliability, plasticity. It's flexible. What humans bring to the table, they tend to project, you know, and I totally do it myself. You know what I'm saying? And I like that. I like that idea. It reminds me of storytelling. You know, of more of an oral tradition than a written history. Oral traditions can have amazing, fantastic themes and ideas and characters in them. You know, something that you don't quite understand can become a fiery beast, you know, or a darkness can become some hidden monster, you know, and it's all real, you know. It may not be true, but it's all real.
Right.
And I find art making is, it comes from that same desire to communicate a complex idea, reduce it down to its like purest form, and then let that go and be a part of the world and allow the viewer to retell that story.
Some of your artwork is animals. What can animals teach us about communicating with each other or teach us about ourselves?
Oh man, we forget that we are animals. And I think in that process, we lose a lot of our humanity by not realizing that we are a part of this place. I like the idea of creating these animal forms and really kind of reducing down what's there so that you're left with the core of what the animal is, you know?
Sure.
And as a way to almost like reverse personify, so animalize things,
right.
You know, animalize the viewer,
us, yes.
You know? Yeah, and like if you can relate to, you know, this fox eating a pheasant or something along those lines, then you can understand more about yourself than if you turn the animal human.
So tell us about your series, Once Upon a Time, There Were Humans.
I wanted to create this idea of a far future where humans no longer exist and the animals are still there, but they've dug up things of humans. Mm-hmm. They found things, traces of our existence, a lot like anthropologists and archaeologists are doing now.
Right, right.
And then they create this whole mythos around what these humans were up to. And I like this idea of them like creating a whole almost theology around this missing species.
Would you share some of your impetus for Stereotypes, that series?
It was really cathartic for me as an artist and as a contemporary Native American person, human in the world. I saw the negative effect of stereotype, but then I also saw that at its core, stereotyping is it's an attempt to understand something you don't understand. Now, the problem that I found was that when you stop at the stereotype, and you're no longer working beyond the understanding, mm-hmm. actually communicating to somebody, but just be like, well, that's the stereotype, and sure. I'm comfortable with that, mm-hmm. you know?
Right.
I understand, you know? So that idea.
I know everything I need to know.
I know everything I need to know, yeah. exactly.
No need to go to the source.
Yeah, yeah, there's no need, you know? Right. So that's that was kind of what I was thinking about. The other thing that I thought about was that the stereotypes are very cerebral. Mm. The stereotypes are ideas, and it's really hard to destroy an idea. So my concept for the show was to actually bind native stereotypes, because this is the lens that I live in, come up with kind of the root of these stereotypes and bind them to ceramic boomboxes, so a type of stereo. My concept was that they are now subject to entropy. These things, these ideas, are bound to something physical. And the physicality of it, the object of it, is now fragile. It can now break. I didn't want to act on it in an aggressive format, because it perpetuates it. You know what I'm saying? Like, you aggressively attack these stereotypes and you're reinforcing them, because you are projecting so much more emotional value on how they affect you. But if you just take the thing, describe it, let it be seen, and then let it go. The universe loves destroying things. You right. know what I'm saying? Like, it was right. so natural.
Entropy.
It, creation is perfect. Everything else,
right.
entropy. It was really interesting, actually, because I used a rock. So I'm in a museum, they've got nice floors. I didn't want to drop these ceramic vessels onto their floor, so I went out into the sculpture garden of the museum and found a rock. And it was funny, because in that process, I realized that the rock was the thing. I was like, that the whole show I did was just for example. But the learning that I got out of it was, be like that rock. That's how you destroy stereotypes. You are absolutely what you are.
What's important to you about your work?
The process, the making. I love that part. Mm-hmm. And I will obsessively do that part, regardless of appreciation. The actual objects, the commodity of, mm-hmm. of the art making, is what's left over from this process of mm-hmm. me making. But it's interesting, because I work in clay, I recognize the fact that once these things are fired, they will never be clay again. They have mm-hmm. gone through a chemical change, you know, quartz inversion, and now right. they are ceramic, and they will be ceramic forever, mm-hmm. you know, beyond that time. They'll never be what they were. And I think about that as far as what I'm leaving in the world. It's gonna outlive me. Mm-hmm. There may be some distant future where some other species that's dominant is digging up these pieces and trying to understand what the human experience was. And I wanna talk about the experience that I know of, this experience of now, you know?
Catalina Delgado Trunk's intricate, paper-based works explore the complex mythologies of pre-Columbian Mexico. Follow member station New Mexico PBS into her rich world.
We all come here and we're all asking the same question. Where do we come from? Why in the world are we here? Where are we going? And every civilization or every culture, every group has to answer those questions for themselves, because it gives it a meaning to your own personal life. Myths answer these questions. They're very, very powerful in every culture. As an immigrant, I lived between two worlds. And for many years, I really didn't feel like I had a sense of place and a sense of identity. All immigrants come with a basket, and there are three things in that basket that we all bring into the country, and that's food, language, and traditions. And I thought, well, then I had to start making use of my three seeds. I found that the easiest way for me was through my artwork, particularly with the oral stories. I am a folk artist, okay? I work papel picado, which is cut paper, and it's called papel cortado or papel picado. Either way, has a very long history. You have to remember that folk art, in whatever discipline it's expressed, is constantly evolving. It's an expression of a particular people, of who they are, their identity. As you search for identity and as you search for a sense of place, you obviously go back to your past. What is it that you heard? What is it that you learned as a child? So you had to dig into the memory, and that's what I started doing. And some of the myths, knew them kind of halfway, so I did a lot of research on them. You can see I have an awful lot of books. I do a lot of reading, and you know, I keep going back to Mexico City and exploring. And I've concentrated on one particular area. It's the southeastern edge of Mexico City. Mixquic, Milpalta, Tecomilt. These are the areas that really stick to the real old traditions. I'm not an anthropologist. I'm not an archaeologist. I just learned a lot of this stuff for osmosis, where I was growing up, family stories, oral histories from neighbors, and just mainly listening to makes me remember a lot of what I was. I was exposed a lot to the codices. The codices are the books that were written in pre-Columbian Mesoamerica, and I think there are only about 22 that survived, most of them in Europe, and I have reproductions of about just all of one. They're all pictographs. It's not writing. I've always been very attracted to them. And growing up in the culture that I did, you're surrounded by all of these symbols. What's interesting in Mesoamerica, the idea of sin, heaven, hell simply did not exist. If you didn't behave during your lifetime, you were punished during your lifetime. But where you went after you died had nothing to do with how you live. It had everything to do with how you died. If you died as a warrior, you went to the sun god as an eagle, and you carried the sun from dawn until noon. Then you'd come back as a hummingbird in the afternoon carrying messages. If you died in childbirth, you also joined the sun and carried the sun from noon until sunset. And in the morning, you'd come back as a butterfly, the monarch butterfly, to bring the hearts of the warriors to the sun. Children that died before the age of 5 went to the land of the nursemaid tree, which was a big tree that dripped milk. And the little children would be restored back to health with this milk. And if you died of old age or another disease or whatever, you went to the Mictlan, the land of Mictlan Tecutli, the Lord of the Underworld. And it took you 4 years to reach there. You had to go through 9 different obstacles. And it was during those 4 years that families were duty-bound to give you the food and the tools necessary to reach the Mictlan. That's your roots of your Dia de Muertos in Mexico. Art is really a very strong medium of universal communication. When you start seeing the humanity of all of us, that we're all here in this little planet all together, and we all have different life experiences, and when you share them, then you have a greater sense of understanding. How else are we going to ever get along if you don't reach out? That's the whole point of it all for me, not, you know, some exhibit in some gallery. Reaching out to people, building bridges, and crossing those bridges, very important to me.
Up next, a rare look at the works of Pulitzer Prize-winning photojournalist Eddie Adams. Adams, who died in 2004, was best known for his 1969 award-winning image, Saigon Execution. WOSU Public Media in Columbus, Ohio, brings us the story.
Eddie Adams won a Pulitzer for the famous Saigon Execution picture where the general is executing a Viet Cong. Eddie didn't like that picture. Lo An, the police chief, in essence, he just took a pistol out of his belt and walked up to him and bang, shot him just like that. Eddie thought this picture didn't tell the whole story. Lo An's aide had been assassinated. His aide's wife had been assassinated, and 4 of their children had been assassinated by a Viet Cong assassination squad. And this guy in the picture was a captain of an assassination squad. And he was in every way a spy. He wore civilian clothes. He was not a military. So Eddie felt that Lo An got a bum rap.
Eddie worked for the AP for a number of years. I think he went to the AP in the early 60s. And I don't think he ever set out to be a war photographer. Eddie grew up in New Kensington, Pennsylvania, which is about half an hour outside of Pittsburgh. He was working for the newspaper when he was in high school. And then he went to the Marines when he was 17 years old. The Marines went to Vietnam in 1965. And that's Eddie followed the Marines over there. You know, the guys trusted him. He was one of them. He was a Marine. Being a Marine really informed the rest of his life. Well, Eddie passed away in 2004, and he had never gone through his work himself. So when he passed away, there was all this body of work, and the first chunk that I thought I would work on is the Vietnam work. And so the idea was to do a book. And so I worked with Hal Buell, who was his former boss at the AP, and these pictures come from the book.
Photography, journalistic photography, was on the edge of a change. It was becoming much more repertorial and not so titillating, but more informative. And Eddie just fit that. Which pictures do I find the most revealing of the war? One is a picture shot from inside of a helicopter looking out, and a woman is reaching up, appealing to be taken aboard the helicopter. And there's absolutely no room on the helicopter. She had her wounded husband with her, and Eddie made the picture, and the helicopter took off and left her behind. And that really affected Eddie. When you know the story, it's a woman begging to be freed from whatever was going to happen next. And then there's another similar picture where in the foreground there's a Vietnamese woman carrying her child and her GIs running this way. There's a firefight going on. And in both cases, what I liked about the pictures was that it showed how close the war was to the civilian population of Vietnam and the people.
There's another story that came later that he wanted to be known for, that he was actually more proud of. And that was the pictures he did on the boat people.
He was very favorable towards the boat people picture, not because of the photography, but because the pictures had an impact on a political situation which involved the opening up the gates to Vietnamese immigration. And it was one of the contributing factors that finally increased the number of Vietnamese who could immigrate to the U.S. In fact, Eddie resented being called a combat photographer or a war photographer because his work was not just Vietnam. That's 2 years of a 50-year career. He did all other kinds of photography.
Thanks for joining us on Art Loft. Connect with us on social media at ArtLoftSFL and watch us anytime on the PBS app by selecting WPBT2 as your local station. For Art Loft, I'm P. Scott Cunningham. See you soon.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art.